NAP Connection is a panel discussion on selected art and art issues with your guest and a host, Ron Schira. Home viewers are invited to call in during the live telecast and offer comments or questions of the artist. NAP Connection is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit art service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. The New Arts Program is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions. Well, hello and good afternoon and welcome to NAP Connection. I'm your host, Ron Schira, and for this program we are visiting, I guess, would be, or no, actually he's visiting us, Steve Scheuring, a special artist who is having a show right now, an exhibition over at Penn State's Freiberger Gallery. And we're going to talk to Steve about his methods, his background, and you know, and a couple of his intentions as well. So I'd like to introduce you to Steve.
Thanks for having me, Ron. Appreciate it.
My pleasure. Absolutely. Glad you're here.
Thank you.
So first off, we'd like you to tell us a little bit about yourself. You know, give us the 100-word wrap.
Yeah. All right. I've lived in Berks County most of my life. I'm married to a lovely wife, Stacy. I have three children, Sarah, Emily, and Cole, that are range from 23 to 17 next week, and a proud father. I work during the day for a company called Airgas, and have always been an artist at heart, have always been drawing and painting in some way. Mm-hmm. And it's nice that I finally have an opportunity to show some of my work.
I agree. I think that I've seen your work in various shows around here, juried and otherwise. Then you've won awards. You've done very well with it, actually. And if you know you were to suddenly break through, you could leave your other job behind and sell paintings for $20,000 each. You know,
would be nice.
Yeah,
would be nice.
Yeah. So you really enjoy being hyper-realistic.
Yes.
So you paint your paintings are associated with sharp delineations of form and color, and they stand out. And also they have what we call an all-over pattern.
Correct.
So that the whole painting is covered. It's like, you know, like that whole, what do they call that, the fear of emptiness?
Right.
Yeah. So the whole painting is covered with objects and images.
Yeah.
So what inspires that?
Well, it really came to me, I think, by a happy accident. I started painting and drawing again eagerly probably back in 2003. A number of things really triggered that. I lost both my grandparents on my mother's side, and in doing so, I reconnected with an uncle that is between my mom's age and my age. And I went over to his house, and I saw that he was painting. Mm-hmm. And this uncle is the same uncle who gave me all of his Mad magazines when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. And he gave me books on the science fiction artist Frank Frazetta. Mm-hmm. And those things really got me into drawing when I was a little kid. And I saw mm-hmm. that he was painting, and I said, ooh, you know, maybe I should be doing painting myself. Mm-hmm. Then my wife and I took a trip to Paris, and just seeing the Louvre and Musée d'Orsay, I came out of that and I was like, you know, I need to paint. Mm-hmm, and since 2003, I've had a painting going ever since. At first, I was trying to fill up space in the house. Mm-hmm. I had wall space, and I'm like, well, I could buy art or I could paint it myself. So, you know, I was painting mm-hmm. the kids, painting vacation spots, you know, doing a lot of landscapes, a lot of portraiture. And I had gotten to a point where I was ready to do a portrait of my son, Cole. And one day we were in the basement and he had, we were playing Hot Wheel cars. And I had long track lined up across the basement floor. And we're shooting the cars back and forth to each other. And he was real cute. I mean, he was, you know, a year and a half old. He's in dinosaur pajamas. We're shooting the cars, and he did what I did when I was a little kid. He would try to look up the track. So he would, you know, bend over and look up the track to see the cars disappearing into the distance. And I'm thinking, man, that's just really cute. So I ran upstairs, said, don't move, grabbed my camera, and I was trying to get pictures of him to do a portrait. And a little context, the week before, I was with my wife and some friends and we were at the Museum of Modern Art. And I just remember coming away from that with an impression that there's an awful lot of artists that are doing something with grids of color.
Right.
You look at like Piet Mondrian and Warhol and the like. There were just a lot at that time that when we were there, just grids with different colors on them. And that made an impression. It just registered. Now, I wouldn't say it was positive or negative. It just registered. And as I'm taking photographs of my son playing with the cars, they really weren't, the photographs weren't working out the way that I thought. But I'm looking at him, and he's taking his Hot Wheel cars, and he's lining them up almost like they're in a parking lot.
In a grid.
In a grid.
Yeah.
And I look down at him, and there's a grid of color. And that triggered the first idea. What if I did a still life painting of cars in a very realistic fashion, but I used the composition techniques of those artists who were doing grids of color? And that led to one of my first paintings in that form, which was Jam. From there, I did another painting, Gridlock, that had a similar theme. And as I was doing the painting, I said, you know, the grids of color is kind of nice, but wouldn't it be interesting to do kind of a Jackson Pollock, you know, a big splash of just all kinds of stuff with cars, which led to another painting, Crash, which led to the next painting, which led to the next painting. So, you know, just kind of that first idea and getting a little bit of success with it, that first painting was very successful in a still life competition with International Artist Magazine. Getting that encouragement and saying, you know, maybe there's something here. And that led to the still lives. The other thing, because of my lifestyle, working during the day, you know, as an artist yourself, you know, when you can really look at the reference, it's you're going to get a much richer painting. It's hard for me to do that when I'm painting at night, often very late into the night. So doing still lives with small objects and toys kind of these, it's born out of my lifestyle. I can hold those objects up to a light while I'm painting. And really get a good look at what's going on.
Well, that would make sense because artists usually paint what they are. So, I mean, what's close to your heart is what you paint. So, I mean, why try to paint like somebody else instead of painting like yourself?
And at the time that I was starting to do that style, you know, what's heavy on my mind is my children, playing with them, looking at their toys, and it reminded me of my youth. So, you know, it was kind of a natural progression from there.
Well, we have a couple of photographs here. Oh, I did want to say one more thing. You have also had some coverage. Can you zoom in on this? Okay, so you have an article going right now in the Reading Eagle, in the Berks and Beyond section, called "Amity Township Artist Comes Full Circle," and this and if you don't have a copy of the Reading Eagle, you should go out and get it, and it'll give you some more background on what we're talking about here. But we're going to talk about his art this time around instead of his other stuff. So let's take a look at some of these photos. Now, this one here is one of your Frazetta influenced.
I must have been 11 years old when I drew that. Again, my uncle, when I was a kid, gave me his Mad magazines and his comic books. And that really sparked the interest. He said, you know, there's this science fiction artist, this guy Frank Frazetta. He's the guy who designed what Conan looks like. And he did, for those who know Molly Hatchet, he did some of the Molly Hatchet album covers. I got some books of his work when I was a kid. My parents got me his books, and I was obsessed with them. I would just sit there and...
Oh, I liked him too. He's a great
artist. Great artist. Copied his images. I'd be there for hours. My mom would say, the house would be burning down. You don't even know it. I'm just so obsessed with it, sitting there drawing his work. So, you know, I do, it's interesting. I go back and I look at some of the old drawings that I did when I was a kid, and I can kind of see the tie from little things that I was doing then that have tied through to my artwork now.
Well, we always start off with, you know, what thrills us.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. Frazetta was a thrill.
Oh, absolutely. In fact, probably one of the best things that my parents did. I mean, if you really look at some of those Frazetta drawings, women had next to no clothes on. And
oh, you know, there was a statement that said, Frazetta draws and paints women better than God.
Well, I don't doubt that.
Yeah. Now, some of them are pretty foxy.
Yeah. But to my parents' credit, you know, here's a 10-year-old kid copying these images. And, you know, their feedback was always, you know, my dad was like, wow, that's cool. You know, that looks great. And it was nice having that encouragement as a little kid.
Oh, yeah, when your parents love what you do, that's the best.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, there was never any, hey, you might want to try something that's less risque. Hey, they were very encouraging.
Yeah, my parents, too. I loved it.
Yeah.
So this next one is called Bowie?
Yeah, I did that in high school. And another nice thing, I took an advanced art class in high school. I went to Schuylkill Valley, and one of the things that they had us do, we had to do a weekly sketch, and I think that was probably the most valuable part of, in my opinion, the most valuable part of that class, just being forced every week to just sit down and do a sketch of something. And this was one of my sketches from that class. I still have my sketchbooks from high school, and you know, learning how to draw just by doing, you know, that whole idea of the 10,000 hours, getting your 10,000 hours.
Being an intern. It's all good. And I mean, you get the likenesses pretty well. I mean, you have a really good eye.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, and it was coming out of high school, what was very nice, I took an oil painting class my last semester at Penn State, and the Frazetta stuff is very, there's a lot of color in the Frazetta stuff, but it's very, you know, dark and, you know, a lot of earth tones. And I was doing a lot of drawing with pencil, so everything was black and white. So my early paintings had a tendency to not have a whole lot of color in them.
Right.
And I was real fortunate that last semester in college to take an oil painting class with a woman named Santa Barraza, who's now, I think, a head of the art program at one of the universities in Texas. And, you know, a Mexican woman, she's like, hey, where's the color? You know, you need to pull the color out and use color. And I can see her influence in my work today just because of how much color I use.
Your colors are very strong. I mean, when you take a look at, we're going to come up on that here pretty soon, but when we see Jam, that's an astounding,
thank you,
clear color.
Thank you.
Can we go to the next one here?
Sure. Yeah, this is some of the earlier work that I was doing when I started painting again. This is actually from that trip in Paris that kind of inspired me to kind of get back into painting, and that's my wife Stacy in the foreground. And real early on, you know, when the kids were young, we were going to the Jersey Shore a lot. I was very attracted to amusement park rides. And in particular, I just love some of the artwork on some of these carousels. I mean, you see the scenes inside of, you know, that are painted into the carousels or some of the giant swings. I was really attracted to that. And I was also attracted to, you know, artificial lighting, you know, dawn, you know, the golden hour. But when everybody turns on the lights and you get that glow, I was really interested in trying to capture that in my work. You know, some of the contrasts of the real warms. With cool backgrounds, I had a lot of fun with that. So yeah, this is one of my early ones.
And I kind of like how the top of the Eiffel Tower there is obscured in the fog there.
Yeah,
it's kind of that's really nice.
Thank you.
That was when I went. I was in San Francisco a couple of years ago, and I saw the Golden Gate Bridge.
Yeah.
And the top of that was totally obscured.
Sure.
You couldn't even see. Couldn't even see it.
Yeah. I thought that was... Yeah, it's one of those sometimes saying less is saying more. I think if the Eiffel Tower were clear as day in that painting, I personally don't think it would be as interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, so this is another early drawing, and for those who are real observant, both my girls are in there, and they're in there twice. So when I actually took some of the reference photography to actually paint the painting, there were not that many people on the swing, but they just kept going around, and I took them at different angles. And I've wiped out everything that was in the background. But again, what attracted me, I just love some of those old carousels and some of the paintings within the paintings. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I get real nostalgic around those rides. So, you know, I had a lot of fun painting that one. This is a great example of sometimes you can't plan it out. This one I call Apple Harmony. I knew I wanted to do an apple still life early on. And, you know, every year we go as a family to pick apples. And I purposefully grabbed a whole bunch of apples that I left the leaves on because I thought the leaves would be interesting on the apples. Mm-hmm. And I took an afternoon and had the sun set perfect and laid out these apples. And I'm taking pictures, and nothing is looking on the camera the way that it looked in my head. I couldn't get any pictures. And I'm sitting at my kitchen table, and I'm looking through my camera, and I have all the apples sitting in front of me, and I look up, and what I'm actually looking at is that accidental scene that in that painting. So I very quickly grabbed the camera, snapped a couple pictures of that, and that's the accident. You know, just getting that nice afternoon reflection off of the table, you know, getting some of the purples and the blues kind of reflecting off the table, and, you know, not seeing a whole lot of details in the apple. You get that, that perimeter lighting peripheral lighting around the outside. I just, it was one of those things I couldn't compose it any better if I wanted to myself.
It's really beautiful. I like the light in it.
Thank you.
The light is as much a subject of this painting as the apples are.
Absolutely. In fact, on that point, when I started painting that, I started putting a lot of detail in the apples, started putting a lot of the little pit marks, and it actually started to not read the right way. It became too confusing. And then I started going in and putting darker glazes over the apples so that you were noticing more of the light, and it didn't become, you know, the apples were more suggested. So.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it works. It really really works well.
Thank you.
Now, as far as technique goes, you mentioned about taking photographs. Do you ever project your photographs, or is it all eye to hand?
Most of the time, the photographs, I'll tell you, with technology advancing the way it has, it's made painting for me very easy, because I can take... you know, a decent photograph, a decent enough for me to paint from, photograph on an iPhone.
Right.
And go to the local Staples, have them print it out large, and I can use that to kind of get the gist of what I need to paint.
Yeah.
And that's usually what I do. And then, you know, for something like the Apple Harmony, I'll grab a couple of the apples and take them in the studio and hit them with the backlighting so that I don't lose what reality looks like.
Right.
But, you know, and taking the photographs and doing the printout, I think as an artist, a lot of artists shy away from that. I actually think it's very helpful because it self-edits. It's taking a lot of the detail out. It's taking and washing a lot of the color out. So it kind of forces you to get that, you know, the basics right. Of the composition, the basics right of how you're putting things down. And then the touches that really kind of bring it to life are things that you have to add after. But just getting it, I think it's a nice shorthand.
Well, sometimes the photography shows you what you shouldn't paint.
Sure.
You know, which is just as important, I think, because sometimes you'll look at a photograph and it will seem okay, but then if you were to translate it into paint, it just doesn't
work.
Doesn't work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think it narrows your palette. You don't get the real contrast of the warms and the cools when you're looking at it. But sometimes the photograph will show you things that you don't necessarily see in reality. On Apple Harmony, there were some really nice reflective blues and purples that when they printed out the photograph, the printer didn't know how to read the colors,
right,
and was laying them down as a real harsh blue or a blue outline.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking at that and saying, that's actually kind of an interesting touch, and I decided to amplify that in the painting. So it's just a matter of being open to, you know, what you're seeing and open to it in reality, and then the
Well, that's the creativity part of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
So if you know, when you see it, when you see something, you can be inspired by it, but actually seeing it doesn't make it.
Right. Correct. Yeah. Yeah. It's just it giving you additional information that you can use to make a decision off of.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I love this one. When I moved in the 90s. I lived in Houston, Texas, and you know, my wife and I both grew up in Redding. We moved to Houston, and we were moving back to the area in '96. And I remember reading Philadelphia magazine, and there was an article about 100 best dates to go on in Philadelphia, and one of them was going to the fights at the Blue Horizon. And my father and I had always watched the fights when I was a kid. I remember watching, you know, all the big fights on Wide World of Sports with my dad, and. You know, I had a fondness for it, and I thought, boy, that would be fun. I've heard about the Blue Horizon. It'd be fun to go to the fights. And I became a regular, so much so that, you know, for the past number of years, I've had ringside seats to the fights that have been down in Philadelphia. And for me, you know, when people hear I'm a fight fan, they start talking about fighters, and I have no idea what they're talking about.
Yeah, yeah.
And it for me, it's more about the scene. You go down to the fights and you're there 6-8 hours, but the people watching is phenomenal. And you know, I've done a number of boxing paintings, and what I've tried to capture in there is not just the fight itself, but that scene that's around the fighting, which
the audience. Yeah,
the audience. I can sit there and just watch people, and I'm curious to know what the story is behind some of these people. There's certain people that I've seen at the fights that are fixtures. You know, there's a figure in that fight, in that painting on the left-hand side, big burly guy, muscular, with his hair slicked back. He's been at every fight that I've ever been at. And I'm you know, want to go talk to him just to understand what this guy's story is. I also, for what's important to me going to the fights is the people that I'm hanging out with, and that gentleman that's in the foreground, that's my father, and you know, sharing the fights with him, the guy in the black leather coat with the blue shirt, sharing the fights with him is really important to me. I really enjoy going to see the fights with my father. The three gentlemen that are to the right of him are three of my good friends, Prentice, Eric Smith, and Vidal, and this guy Vidal really is that big. The guy's a giant. And the guy in profile on the far left, I do like doing that in some of my paintings, putting something in the very extreme foreground to kind of pull the viewer into the painting. You know, you see like Toulouse-Lautrec would do that. He'd put something really in the extreme foreground. That's a friend of mine, Bob, who sadly passed away a few years ago. But if you look at all the people that are in that crowd, those are actual people that would be out at the fights. I had somebody very early on give me a strong art critique, and they said, you know, one of the things that you need to do in your painting is wash out the people's faces. You got to make them more generic, and your work would be more sellable. I'm like, you know, that's a bunch of crap. I am very fascinated by, you know, people, and I love watching people, and there's no better place to watch it than at the fights. You could stand there next to somebody and just say, hey, who do you like in this next fight? And make a friend forever. It's that kind of an environment. People are very laid back. It's a good cross-section of the population, and people are very, very friendly. It's not, you know, people have this impression you go to the fights and people are looking to start a fight.
Yeah.
It's not that at all.
No, they're just going there to blow off steam.
They're going there to have a good time, and there's a lot of downtime, so people are willing to talk. And I love that about the fights. So hopefully that captures it.
Well, I think that's part of the charm of your work, too, is the details. Yeah. I mean, because you can see the faces on people and how they're looking at things. They're serious or not serious.
Sure.
I mean, all of that adds to the atmosphere of what you're doing. If you were to wash out all those faces and concentrate only, you know, on a, like, what was his name, Bellows, who did the fights, and just concentrate entirely on the characters that are fighting.
Yep.
It changes the whole attitude of it.
It's a different painting.
Yeah.
You know, it's capturing a different vibe. One of the little details that I love in this painting, in, on the far right, whenever you go to the fights, there's when guys are talking and they start talking about the fights, everybody starts pulling up their hands and they start, you know, this guy, yeah, he's got a great left hook. Well, they can't say the guy's got a great left hook. They got to act like they're throwing a left hook. And right. I actually captured that in, you know, a guy talking to another guy and it looks like he's actually throwing a punch. Mm-hmm. And you see a lot of that. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, the story about this one, we were sitting ringside at the fight, and the two gentlemen that are fighting, the one in the gold trunks is from Mexico City, and the guy in the red trunks was from the Bronx. And we were sitting ringside, and there was a whole group of people speaking Spanish next to us. And we introduced ourselves, and we started talking. They're like, oh, what brings you down? And they said, oh, the one gentleman, his father said, my son is fighting in the feature fight. They brought a whole group of people in from Mexico City to see their son fight. And so we had a big group of people with us. We started cheering this fighter on, had a great time with it. Mm-hmm. Well, this fighter's wife couldn't deal with the pressure of the fight. If you look to the far right, there's a woman with her hands over her face standing up with a black purse.
Yes.
Every time her husband, that's the wife of the guy in gold, every time he would get hit, she would flinch.
No.
And I mean, and she was feeling every single punch, like, oh my goodness. Mm-hmm. And my friend Eric said, that'd be a great painting. So I immediately started snapping shots of her. Just focusing on her wouldn't have made a great painting. I figured the scene would be more interesting. What's mm-hmm. neat about that, the woman just to her front, holding the little boy, is the wife of the other fighter, the one from the Bronx. Mm-hmm. And that other little boy that's in the foreground, those two boys were hers. She was oblivious to the fight. She was, you know, the boys are walking around. She was worried about her boys. Her husband's getting pounded in the ring. She had no idea what was going on. So it was just real interesting seeing the contrast between mm-hmm. the fighters' wives. So, again, this is another one where I think the crowd, you know, to me was a more interest. I mean, the fight was a great fight, but mm-hmm. it's of equal interest to me as the fighting itself. And I know most people wouldn't pick up on the fact that those are the fighters' wives initially, but I purposefully put the fight off center to draw your attention to the people in the crowd, and hopefully you dwell on that a little bit when you're looking at the painting.
Well, that's an interesting aspect to this. Now, the size of these paintings. I mean, what kind of dimensions are we talking about?
Yeah, that one there is 10 inches tall by 30 inches wide. You know, most of my paintings I'd call mid to large. And when you're trying to capture that kind of detail, I would rather paint large. It's easier to get the detail in there. And a lot of these are composites. That previous one was probably 40 different photographs I've used to assemble to get that painting. This one's probably a half dozen photographs.
So you do a lot of research for each one of these.
Yeah, and I'll take aspects of one shot that work. Mm-hmm. You know, the cameraman's in the wrong position. I'll find the cameraman in the right position just to mm-hmm. you know, make the photograph the painting
more interesting.
Work.
Yeah, it's nice.
Yeah, so this is the painting that we talked about earlier on. This is Jim. So this was the painting that was the output of me trying to do a portrait of my son. What was interesting when I was actually doing the photography, again, the happy accident, mm-hmm. when I was looking straight down on the image and taking photography, it wasn't that interesting.
Right.
But when I skewed the angle a little bit, I thought, ooh, I've got something there. And, so the painting didn't turn out the way I was conceiving it, but I was very happy with the output.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I like how you got all of the logos and the lettering and all that. It seems like there's no end to the detail in these.
What was a nice little outcome of this painting, this was featured in International Artist Magazine, mm-hmm. and I got a letter after that. There's a gentleman named Steve Vandervate, who's one of the designers of Hot Wheel cars, mm-hmm. and he said, I just got back from a convention. I thought I couldn't look at another Hot Wheel car, and I saw your painting in International Artists. It made my day. And so I got a chance to have a nice little correspondence back and forth with him, and he said, what's your favorite car? And I said, it's the Surf Woody in the foreground. Because my earliest memories of drawing are sitting down with mm-hmm. my brother mm-hmm. and drawing, you know, rat rod cars and you know, with the guys in the car with the tongue hanging out and their eyeballs popping out.
Oh yeah, yeah, 70s. Yeah. Basil Wolverton and those guys.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And he said, yeah, that's exactly what inspired that. And mm-hmm. A week later in the mail, I get this tube and I open it up and it's some copies of the production drawings of that car. It's mm-hmm. really nice. So that's one of the things I've loved about you know, my art. I've been able to make a lot of different friends at a lot of different places, and you know, it makes
it's so diverse too. I mean, you wouldn't realize that Big Daddy Roth would be a inspiration here for that, you know. But yeah, it is. It's very cool. So
yeah, this I then came back and revisited the subject and wanted to get the straight down grid of colors. Mm-hmm. So this one is called Gridlock. I tried to amp up, you know, just. As I was collecting cars, I saw one. The one that really caught my eye was the Hellman's mayonnaise. Like, it just seemed comical to me, somebody advertising mayonnaise on a car. Mm-hmm. So as I was putting this one together, I was purposefully trying to find, you know, I think if you follow the diet that's in this painting, you're going to have some problems. Tabasco sauce, Red Bull, State Fair corn dogs, Hellman's mayonnaise.
Yeah, Reese's peanut butter, McDonald's.
Yeah. So I thought some of the different companies that were advertising on cars were kind of interesting, and tried to find the most interesting ones to put in here.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I get people say, well, why don't you have the number 5? Why don't you have this guy's number? I'm not a diehard fan. It's just I like the cars. I think they're interesting mm-hmm. looking. I mm-hmm. like some of the logos on them.
Well, they're toys too.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
They're toys. They're not. They're not real cars.
Yeah.
You know, and people that would mistake them for real cars that. Get a life.
Yeah. So this is the Jackson Pollock inspired painting. This is Crash. Mm-hmm. And, you know, even though I was trying to go for that, you know, to your point, a total all over composition, totally abstract, no, you know, center of interest, I couldn't help myself. And, you know, that monster truck, if you see how all the mm-hmm. kinds, cars kind of lead to that monster truck. It's actually a classic pyramidal composition. But, mm-hmm. you know, that wasn't my original intent. My original intent was to mimic a Jackson Pollock. And, you know, that painting kind of led to the next one. That one was actually shown up in Allentown, at the Allentown Art Museum. Mm-hmm. And one of the guys said, I noticed that, you know, your paintings are about shapes, repeating the same shapes over and over again. Mm-hmm. I was like, wow, I'm not purposefully trying to do that, but it was interesting that that was his perspective. Mm-hmm. And from there, it made me think, you know, one of the shapes I think is most interesting is a human form. Mm-hmm. And it led to some additional paintings later, one called A Pile of Soldiers, where I was thinking, mm-hmm. you know, what's an interesting form? Well, a car's an interesting form, but how about a person? Mm-hmm. And as a kid, I played with G.I. Joes, so it just naturally led to taking soldiers and putting them in a pile. And that, we could talk about that painting in a bit.
Well, we're going to be seeing that. And this is Cole, right?
That's Cole. That's the portrait that I ultimately did of Cole. And what inspired this one was he was 8 years old. We're watching TV, and a thing came on TV about a serial killer. So, you know, here I am trying to explain to an 8-year-old boy what a serial killer is. And, you know, after I explained it to him, I told him the truth. You know, I kind of swallowed hard and explained to him what a serial killer is, and he's looking at me all confused. And I said, you thought that had something to do with breakfast cereal, didn't you? And he said, yeah. So, you know, what went from a serious moment, we started sitting there chuckling, and I'm, you know, having a good time with him. And, mm-hmm. you know, that kind of mixed emotion that I had at the time was something I thought, you know, there between that and the cereal itself, there's got to be a painting in here somewhere.
Well, better to learn about something like that from your father than someone else.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure. But if you look at this painting, I mean, you can just view it as simple nostalgia, you know, of breakfast cereal from when you were a kid. But if you look at some of the images that are in there, the Frankenstein, a pirate, a mummy, an alien, you know, those are pretty scary images. All with, you know, they're all kind of killers. Mm-hmm. So I purposely, the title of this is Serial, S-E-R-I-A-L.
Yeah.
Another interesting note to this, I was at work with a friend in Boston. I'm explaining this painting to him, And he said, oh, it'd be neat if you got a Wheaties box at an O.J. Simpson and put that in the painting. And I thought, yeah, that's actually brilliant. So I did some research online, and there actually never was an O.J. Simpson's Wheatie box. Mm-hmm. But there was a breakfast cereal in the 70s called O.J.'s. So I actually found a refrigerator magnet for that cereal and put it in there. So it's kind of my own little nod to myself.
Mm-hmm. So you would go out and acquire these things.
Yeah.
If you didn't have them, right?
Yeah, I'd eBay.
Yeah.
So, you know, actually a lot of the bobbleheads I found at a store up in New England. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I think about the objects that I want in there. One of the cereals that's in there is a Freaky cereal. And I remember playing with my brother these little cars, and you had a bulb, and you squeeze the bulb, and it would shoot the car across the floor.
That was probably the best,
in my mind, the best cereal, the cereal prize mm-hmm. of all of them. And I mm-hmm. actually found a couple of those on eBay. So,
oh, that's cool.
You know, just had to include those because those were my favorite.
We used to have those, and then we would
hit
the, you know, shoot it. And then boom, they'd shoot out like a shot then. This one is a major piece.
Thank you. That's super. And again, I'm just trying to capture all different types of superheroes, and you'll see in there both DC, you'll see Marvel, and you'll see some real subtle ones that are in there, like the Sandman at the bottom, and there's the Watchmen in there, and there's actually Hit Girl.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of different things in there.
Well, a lot of this stuff is also, in Green Lantern and, you know, in Hulk, and there's a bunch of different things in here. I lost my thought there. But anyway, there's a lot of references here to the culture that's happening right now.
Sure.
With the superhero craze. I mean, it's like everything has been, all of the entertainment in the area, supposedly, seemingly, is being dominated by superheroes in incredible, almost insane situations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'd say we live in a great time that they're able to, I think, because all those stories that I imagined in my head as a kid are now coming to life on the screen, and in ways that are better than I could ever imagine in my head.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the technology is advanced, that some of the storytelling that they can do is incredible. So I think it's a wonderful thing.
Oh, me too. And Star Wars, too. There was something I just found out about Star Wars. The early days of space tabloid, or space travel and science fiction tabloids, they had a magazine out there called Spafon.
Okay.
And Spafon was the remark that an alien made when they were surprised. You know, it was like, Spafon, you know. Oh, you know. What I heard, too, was in the very first Star Wars, in A New Hope, they had an alien say that.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah, yeah. And I didn't realize that at the time. You know, when I heard it, I thought, that's a strange word, you know?
Right.
But later on, I found out that they...
I love that.
Yeah. They incorporate all this stuff, you know?
Yeah, it's funny. I love... You know, there's blatantly obvious things that are in my paintings, but I also love... I hide my kids' names. I hide little things that I know about and most other people would never pick up on, and it's my own little and I when I see the painting hanging on the wall and I see that little thing that I hid in there, I get a kick out of it.
Yeah, that's something just for you.
Sure.
Just for you and just for your family.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's I think that's important. That there are some things that only belong to you.
Sure. Sure. This painting was a happy accident. I was in my basement, and that Sex Pistols album cover was sitting on the top of my albums. And just the pink and the green, I thought, I've got to be able to build a still life. I'm going to challenge myself to build a still life around those colors and try to balance it out. So, you know, the blue Russian nesting dolls, the little monsters. I just thought they were cool. The tangerines, because I just thought I needed a strong enough color to kind of offset the pink and the green. But most of the stuff that's in here is, you know, music that I grew up with that that I love. The title of the painting is Nevermind. And just a weird, weird coincidence. I'm painting the painting, and I painted the Nevermind from Nevermind the Bullocks on the Sex Pistols cover. And a couple hours later, I'm working on the Nirvana cassette tape that's in the foreground, and I'm looking, and the title of that cassette is Nevermind. So here I am. I started painting the word Nevermind. I'm like, where have I just seen that word? And I look at the painting, and it's right above it. I wish I could say I planned it, but I didn't. The word Nevermind appeared twice. And then when I started doing the Bob Marley album, the CD cover, there's actually a reflection of the word Nevermind in there. So the word Nevermind actually appears in the painting three different times. So I thought, well, that's somebody's talking to me there. I need to use that. So hence the title of the painting is Nevermind.
Nevermind, yeah. Well.
This one, I love Christmas. It's my favorite holiday.
Me too.
I just thought it'd be fun to work with the Christmas lights and trying to capture some of the reflections off the Christmas lights. I diehard Rankin Bass guy. I watch all of, you know, Rudolph, Year Without a Santa Claus.
Yeah.
I love them all. So I wanted to try to capture all of that in one painting. And this painting is actually named by my oldest daughter, Sarah. It's called Insanity, with the name Santa in the middle. So I thought that was kind of cute. There's a lot of nostalgia in this one. Actually, there's a photograph, a Polaroid photograph. One of my earliest memories is of Christmas when I was a little kid. And I remember having these little foot pajamas on and having noisemakers and blowing up a balloon and somebody taking a Polaroid of that. And I was actually able to borrow that Polaroid from my parents and put that in the painting.
Nice. Yeah. I mean, really, when you go through these, you can see all kinds of different stuff, you know. And it also kind of says something to me about, like you say, the insanity of Christmas and the time of the entire season, and how there's such an overglut of product and marketing and color and all of that stuff pouring in at that time.
And what a great thing. You know, I wouldn't have it any other way.
No, nor I. Nor
yeah, I love, mm-hmm. I love, you know, the commercialism and that, you know, people look at that and say, you know, the season's too long. And I think it's wonderful.
Well, it's a great time of year for children, I think.
Sure.
Yeah.
And that's it, aren't we all?
Yeah. Aren't we all kids at heart? Now, this one here refers to art, what's called commercial art,
It's called commercial art, This was born out of, I hadn't been down to the Barnes exhibit in Philadelphia. I went down and I took a docet tour of the Barnes Museum. And for those who aren't familiar with it, Barnes was made an awful lot of money in the late 1800s off the pharmaceutical industry. And this guy started collecting art. Mm-hmm. And he collected what I think is the largest collection of impressionistic art outside of France. And he was able to acquire that and bring it into Philadelphia.
More Cezannes than anybody in the world.
An amazing, amazing collection. For anybody who gets a chance, it's well worth going into Philadelphia to see the Barnes. What was interesting, though, the docent was telling me that, you know, Barnes tried to donate his entire collection to the Philadelphia Art Museum. And they just looked at him and said, no, we don't want your art, because he came from new money. His money wasn't old enough, which therefore meant it wasn't good enough. And I don't know about you, but that just ticked me off. I heard that story and I'm like, you know, and now the Philadelphia Art Museum would love nothing more than to get their hands around his collection. After I went to the Barnes, I went over to the Philadelphia Art Museum, And they have that Rocky statue that's down on the front. They can't have it on their property because it's not fine art.
Yeah.
But you see all these people around the Rocky statue and running up the steps and putting their hands in the air. And, you know, what a great piece of art about the city of Philadelphia and representing, you know, our city mm-hmm. as the movie Rocky. And again, that just struck a very hypocritical note in my mind mm-hmm. That, oh, they can't have that statue on the property. But when you go in the art museum and you go in their store, they're selling little Rocky statues in their store.
So it's okay for some, but not for others.
Yeah, like exactly. Yeah, okay. And they were selling, what really struck me as funny is they had this collection of finger puppets of famous artists that they were trying to sell. So just...
finger puppets.
You know, here they are in one breath. Ooh, we can't have this commercialize our art. It's got to be fine art. Mm-hmm. But just go in the store and see the stuff that they're trying to sell, and it tells mm-hmm. you a completely different story. Yeah. So this is my attempt to kind of you know, make fun of you know, the seriousness around fine art, and everything in here is art, fine art commercialized in some form. Now, I don't think that's a bad thing. I think that's a wonderful thing. But I try to capture probably some of the most famous art and artists of the last 200 years mm-hmm. in this painting. And I'm celebrating it. I'm not saying commercialization is a bad thing.
Well, you got some from the Renaissance there, too. You got a Botticelli, Birth of Venus, and well, and then Mona Lisa. And both of those are from the 15th century.
Sure, the Sistine Chapel. Mm-hmm. You got Andrew Wyeth in there, Keith Haring, Grant Wood, you know, just in the finger puppets, mm-hmm. you know, Frida Kahlo, Salvador Dali, who's one of my favorite artists. Yeah, there's a little bit of everything in there.
Oh, yeah. And the Jeff Koons puppy.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah, the balloon. And that's actually a Jeff Koons balloon dog bank. So if you notice on the back, there's actually a nice little slot.
It's a piggy bank.
Yeah.
That's funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now the ants that are crawling around there, is that a reference to David Weinrowitz?
No, actually it's more to Salvador Dali and Persistence of Memory, the melting watch with the ants crawling around.
Okay.
So yeah, I found a nice little, you know, some plastic ants that I put on there. And originally, I was going to paint the ants to look very realistic, like real ants. And I said, no, it looks actually better if they look like plastic ants. And a lot of people think they're spiders. That's okay. But, yeah, I had fun with that one.
Yep, they're ants.
Yeah, this is a painting I'm very proud of. This is my attempt to tip the hat and celebrate everything in my that is Berks County.
Right.
So again, it's that all over design. I hope people get lost in that painting when they're looking at it. And there's a lot of things in there that are special to me.
Well, we actually urge people to go over to this show and see it, because it's up until February the 21st, correct?
February 21st. And for this painting and for the Penn State painting, which has a tremendous amount of detail in it, both of those paintings actually have a key next to it. So if you're looking at something in the painting and you don't know how it references Berks County, there's actually an explanation mm-hmm. Right along with the painting.
So the title of this painting is We Are Berks.
It's called Berks County, yeah.
Oh, Berks County, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And some of the little hidden things in there, you know, if you look at, you know, the Fifth Avenue candy bar.
Right.
Ludens made that at Fifth Avenue in Reading. You know, so most people in Reading know, you know, Fifth Avenue is a famous street.
Right.
You ask most people and you say, what's the next most famous road in Berks County? And I think you'd probably get the road to nowhere. You know, we all know before they built the 222 bypass, mm-hmm. that little stretch of highway was known as the road to nowhere. Well, if you look at the Fifth Avenue candy bar closely underneath, it says Fifth Avenue and then it says, and the road to nowhere.
Ah.
So, you know, one of those little, you know, rewards for somebody who's really, really observant looking at the painting.
Well, you could spend days looking at this.
Yeah.
Really. And you got the mushrooms there for the mushroom factories up
there. The mushroom factories. Uh-huh. I'm a pretzel junkie, so I try to include, unique splits are my favorite. So I've got Sturgis in there. I've got some Bell Alley pretzels in there. You know, the big soft pretzels that are made here in the city.
Astor Theater.
Astor Theater. And I took some liberty there. I wanted to make sure that I put John Constantine from...
Yeah. My Big Fat Greek Wedding.
Yeah, in Room 222.
We met him.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, my daughter and I met him. My daughter had a selfie done with him.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah, she loves that guy.
I hear he's a great guy. I've never met him, but...
so friendly.
I had to include him, so he's actually on the marquee of the Astor. I don't know if he ever was, but he is now.
Welcome. All right, we have a few minutes left here. It's probably about 5 minutes, right?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so we're getting, now this is what, We Are Berks?
This is We Are, which is the painting about Penn State. And really what inspired this, if you look at the far right, it's kind of hard to see, there's a football card in there for a gentleman named Wallace Triplett, who just passed away a month ago. Wallace Triplett was the first African-American player in the NFL to actually play in a game. When he went into the NFL, there were actually, I think, three players that were drafted. I think one was drafted ahead of him, but he was actually the first player to play. Mm-hmm. A lot of Penn State people don't know where the We Are cheer comes from. And if you go to a football game, they have this cheer where half the stadium goes, We Are! And the rest of the stadium goes, Penn State! And it just, this amazing sound in the stadium. Mm-hmm. Well, that cheer was born out of a story in the 60s, very early 60s. Penn State was invited to play in a game in Florida, and they said, leave your black players home. And the Penn State players all got together and said, no, we are Penn State. You either play all of us or you play none of us. The following year, Penn State got into the Cotton Bowl. Same story. They said, leave your black players home. And they said, we are Penn State. You either play all of our players or you play none of our players. And they actually had trouble getting into the one hotel because they said, you will put all of us in this hotel. Mm-hmm. And they couldn't get them in, so they actually took the players to a military base in San Antonio and stayed in San Antonio before the game and actually drove up to Dallas to the Cotton Bowl to be able to play.
Wow.
And that's where that We Are cheer was, it was a born out of that story. Well, I heard that, and I don't know about you, but that just struck a tremendous amount of pride in me, in my alma mater. And I thought, you know, as Penn Staters, there's an awful lot that we have to be proud of. And this was my attempt to try to celebrate all of that.
Mm-hmm. Well, there was a number of different references here, too, towards popular characters in stories and stuff, like the Hulk. What was his name?
Bruce Banner.
Bruce Banner.
Yeah.
He went to Penn State.
Yeah.
Imaginary character went to Bruce and Penn State.
That was a great thing that I learned in the research. I was like, wow, that's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of people. The gentleman who was the photographer who took the picture of the Afghan girl, the famous National Geographic cover, he's a Penn State grad. Joseph Heller, who wrote Catch 22, he was a professor at Penn State. Mm-hmm. Fisher from Fisher Price went to Penn State. The husband and wife team that invented the Slinky are Penn State grads. So there's a lot of that in here. And then, you know, Berks County's own, Kerry Collins, Lenny Moore, both Penn State grads. And I was able to capture both those guys, not only in the Penn State painting, but in the Berks County painting as well.
So quit saying that the Reading area is nowhere. One here is just a straightforward portrait.
Straightforward portrait. This was taken off of a reference photo. A good friend of mine, his name is Buddy Eliezer, takes trips to Africa every year and does wildlife safaris. And he owns the business and coaches people on how to set up their cameras to take certain shots. Mm-hmm. But when they go to Namibia, he takes photographs of the Himba tribe. Mm-hmm. And this was a photograph that he took of a young girl in the Himba tribe. And I thought originally it was a young boy, but you can actually tell, a buddy told me it's a girl. The boys have one braid in the front and the girls have two braids in the front. So you can actually use that to differentiate the boys and girls. I fell in love with the photograph, asked them if I could use it to do a painting, and this was the result. And as a little tribute to Buddy, if you really look at the girl's eyes, there's a reflection of the photographer in her eyes, and that's my friend in her eyes.
How about that?
Yeah.
Well, we have, we're out of time, actually. I was given the 1 minute warning here. There's like three more shots here, but we won't get to them. I do want to say thank you.
Thank you, Ron. Real pleasure in meeting you and talking to you.
Oh, my pleasure as well. Is there anything new coming up for you? Anything else?
I've got a bunch of more still life paintings that I'm working on, and just hope everybody keeps following me. There's a lot more to come.
A lot more to come, which is good. You're an excellent painter.
Thank you.
And I am now given the goodbye signal, which means we have to say goodbye.
Thanks, Ron. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks again. Thanks for watching NAP Connection. I'm Ron Schira with Steve Scheuring, and have a wonderful night.
Thank you.
NAP Connection originates from the Berks Community Television Studios in Reading, Pennsylvania. Please check your local listings for airtimes. For more information, please contact the New Arts Program at 610-683-6440 or visit the exhibition space at 173 West Main Street in Kutztown.